Hello, hi everyone. So I'm just going to give you a bit of background to this research project. This is all based on my PhD data and thesis, which is still a work in progress. I'm just going to give you a bit of a background to several areas. It's a collaboration between the British Library and the University of Sheffield. So the British Library's got a huge sound archive, including lots of oral histories within that. I'll explain a bit more about oral histories in a minute. They've got some that are some collections that are exclusively about food, and others where food comes into it a lot. So these are some of the names of them. Now, a few years ago, before they funded this PhD that I did, they were quite interested in the sort of more political and activist side, and felt that wasn't really represented there, and wanted that to be more present. So that's kind of how my research came about. And so all of the recorded oral histories will be are in the process of being put into a public archive that will be accessible to anyone, and that's all happening kind of at the moment. So if you're interested to go and listen to them in detail, then you can there. And we're very privileged today because we have Helen Crawley, who is one of the people I interviewed, in fact. So if you want to ask her any questions later about what the experience is like from her side of it, then I'm hopefully she will be happy to answer. What is oral history and kind of life stories approach? So it was a discipline that emerged in the 20th century. It was seen as giving voice to the marginalised. So it kind of actually started out as quite an activist movement within itself. So it was challenging the sort of orthodox historical methods of the time, and was sort of questioning this assumption that, you know, someone's written account is the truth and there's only one truth. It's talking about actually there are multiple truths, everyone has a different version, but also it's living, and history is in the kind of living memory, and it's alive, and it's kind of constantly changing as well, and especially when it's recent history, that with people who are still alive. It actually kind of started a lot documenting things like labour struggles, racial and ethnic minorities and women, often people who are illiterate who would just simply be ignored in history. So it was really seen as a kind of opening history up to them and making sure that their accounts were also documented. I'm just going to very quickly read this quote, which I think is quite a nice one. This is, it's kind of seen as a valuable method for understanding the past, the interplay between the past and present, and the relationship between the individual, the organisational, and the structural in shaping society, often used to look at social change. And it's probably worth mentioning as well, oral history life stories takes a whole life approach. So when you interview someone, you really are asking about all aspects. You're not just asking them about your particular research interest, you're looking at the whole picture. As a result of that, they can be quite long. So they tend to be anywhere between 4 and 20 hours. So it's serious qualitative research here that we're doing. And there's a bit of background on food activism. Probably most of you here don't need much introduction, but food activism in Britain has got quite deep roots and has intensified post-war. This kind of started more with sort of things like the kind of 19th century corn laws and problems with malnutrition, food adulteration scandals, and then rationing during the First and the Second World War as well. It's really exploded a lot in the last few decades, reacting to the kind of productivist agricultural policies and the liberalised trade regimes, and even more so very recently fueled by various food scares that we've had in the kind of the last couple of decades as well. The food movements have been addressing all these sorts of issues, agriculture, animal welfare, local and seasonal food, trade, types of diets, public health, food safety, famine, food waste. These are some of the main issues that the food movements have been addressing. How alternative these might be is something that's also contested. So if you want to kind of look into that debate, then these are some useful authors to look at who are questioning that. And also just a note, so this is called, the collection is called Food Activism. I haven't changed that name. I still might at the moment. I'm sticking with it. Some of the people I interviewed didn't actually necessarily relate to the term themselves. A lot of them saw themselves more as campaigners. They all had kind of various ways that they identified with it or not. One of them did actually say at one point, it's for them, activism means creating change beyond oneself. And I really liked that. And that was more or less the sort of working definition that I was using already. So I found that quite helpful. So I've kind of adopted that as the sort of basis for what I mean by activism when talking about this. So creating change beyond just oneself. So as I mentioned, this is part of my PhD research. It's a collaboration, as I mentioned, with the British Library and Sheffield University. I collected in total 17 oral history interviews, ranging between 4 and 16 hours, each of them. Oral history kind of overlaps with various other disciplines anyway, so there were kind of elements of ethnography as well. And so I interviewed people from a range of organisations and movements. Some of them had only worked in one issue or one organisation their whole life. Others had actually worked independently, but on particular issues and collaborating with various organisations and covering a broad range of issues. And I did also use some other material that was already at the British Library. In particular, there were some other oral history collections already there that touched on food issues that I was able to reuse as secondary data as well. At this point is when I'm going to note that I'm currently writing the thesis, and so I'm very much developing all the ideas that I'm talking about today. So, and as anyone who's done a PhD has probably experienced, there are times that you can feel quite stuck with the data and rather too immersed in it. So there are some times I'm kind of struggling to interpret it, or you know, I get a bit stuck, whatever. So I'm also using this as I'm afraid I'm not just giving you information. I'm going to be wanting. I'm looking forward to the conversation at the end and any light that any ways that you can kind of interpret things or things that you see. I'd be very, very interested to hear about. So, any feedback would be most welcome. And this is very much a discussion. So these are the sort of main organisations that were sort of represented. So I interviewed people from the Fair Trade Foundation, GM Freeze, Sustain, Soil Association, Sustainable Food Trust, Friends of the Earth, Oxfam, Compassion World Farming, Growing Communities, Food Cycle, UK Health Forum, Hughes Fish Fight, Food for Life, Food Ethics Council, First Steps Nutrition, and the author of Meat to Banana Extravagance. So, I mean, there were actually many more issues and organisations that people have been involved in, but this is sort of the main gist of it. I'm not going to go into this in too much detail, and I'm not going to go through each of them in this talk. I'm going to pick out a few ones in particular, but these were sort of my main areas of interest when I set out doing the research. So things that sort of emerged and that I was starting to explore a lot more as I was doing the research and as I've been kind of processing it. So one of them was childhood and early adult life influences. This, I'm actually going to talk about this in a bit more detail in a minute, but they're kind of, the people I interviewed were from different ages, but they generally all shared a kind of similar history and era that they grew up in. I'll talk about that a little bit more. I'm also going to be talking about social class a bit more in a bit. And I've mentioned about the kind of food activist identity and actually identifying more as campaigners. And the two things that I'm not going to go into a lot of detail in a minute, so I'm just going to talk a little bit now. One of them is optimism. Now, what was quite interesting was that all the people I interviewed in different ways were fundamentally very optimistic people. Now, maybe this isn't surprising, given that they were trying to challenge these massive issues in the food system. Some of them had some very antagonistic relationships with optimism, and they would kind of sway between kind of being like, oh yeah, absolutely fine, that we're gonna get there somewhere, and look at all these examples of these incredible feats in history and of slavery, and you know, they would pick out these big things, and this is what we're kind of driving forward. And there was just no way that their, you know, their kind of optimism would waver, and their absolute fundamental belief in the things that they were changing, even if they felt that it wouldn't happen in their lifetime, they felt that it was possible. Others were kind of sway between kind of going, yeah, and then the next minute going, oh, why am I doing this? This is all far, you know, it's never going to happen. These are two big issues. But they all had quite a significant relationship with optimism. And this kind of essential drive to feel that they kind of wanted and needed to be addressing these issues. I would say actually one thing that was quite interesting to note, but mainly because of the lack of it, ethnic diversity. I mean, this may have just been very poor on my side for selecting people, but it was very, very hard to find non-white people in the food movement. I know there are some, but they're not very predominant. And actually, more interestingly, it was one of the issues that that kind of, if it didn't really kind of emerge in any of the conversations, and then when I would, if I did bring it up, you know, most of the people that I interviewed were kind of actually fairly oblivious to it. They kind of hadn't, you know, they didn't really have anything necessary to say, or they kind of wouldn't, would some of them would kind of completely misinterpret the question. It just wasn't kind of on their radar at all. And this is in no way to kind of against these people at all. This is just, it was just interesting. You know, I remember struggling when I was trying to identify people to approach to interview in the first place, and then once I was interviewing, this was just a massive gap that was quite hard to fill, which I think is actually quite shocking given how diverse the UK is and how global the food system issues are as well. So. So I'd kind of mentioned they had the shared history. So most of the people that I interviewed, they had grown up in a kind of very much meat to veg Britain. If they were not directly, then their parents had been very influenced by rationing and that kind of sense of not wasting food that had come out of the First and Second World Wars. They'd also grown up in this kind of era of the huge industrialization of agriculture, convenience foods. We've got Angel Light here and Smash and these other lovely products. They also grew up in this sort of punk hippie counterculture era, the nuclear disarmament movements and the rise of environmental movements and kind of key works such as Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. So whether or not they were kind of directly engaged in these, aware of them, interested in them, this is basically the sort of environment that they were growing up in. Of course, they each had their own experiences within this, and you know, slightly different ages and so on. But yeah, this was essentially their kind of shared experience. Now, social class. This is an interesting one. I'm still kind of struggling to get through how muddy this is. I mean, you know, as most people know, in the UK, we're kind of obsessed with social class. But it's just really not as clean cut as we like to think it is at all. You know, some people sort of outside, you know, when I just sort of have general conversations with people about the research I was doing, or, you know, some people would have these assumptions that the sorts of people who are involved in sort of political movements of this class or that class or whatever, actually, that just, you know, wasn't the case. All the people that I interviewed, not only were they from a whole range of classes, there was no way that I could say, oh, they were all from this, you know, they all identify with this social class. They all had very mixed relationships with themselves. They felt aligned, or maybe not aligned to either of them. Some of them hadn't really thought about it at all. Others had a lot. Others felt very confused about it, and they'd kind of felt that they belonged here, but then because of this experience they then kind of shifted to here, and actually quite a lot of them, through the experience of sort of becoming politicized and educated about the food system, felt that also changed quite a lot. Or sometimes they didn't feel any change, but their family maybe saw how, you know, they thought, oh well, you do something rather different now, and this isn't kind of what we expected, or, you know, what you're involved in doesn't really fit with what we're doing, and so on. So it's very muddy. that's kind of my main conclusion so far. It's complex, it's mixed. The assumptions basically don't add up, and people's kind of identity with a particular social class just are not how we think they are. So one of the main things, when I went into, you know, I work in food, I think food is special. And, you know, I had this sort of fundamental belief, you know, it is special, you know, however politicized you might be about other issues, there's something different about food. It's not like energy or housing or whatever else, you know, it's an inherently social and cultural and emotional, as well as political, economic, environmental issue. It's, you know, it's to do with our health. We absolutely have to encounter it, indeed, ingest it physically several times a day. There's no way that we can, you know, ignore it. Of course it's special, and, you know, think about it, every major cultural celebration that we have in societies around the world has some kind of food tradition component as part of it. So I kind of thought this, you know, surely this is the big attraction for people working in food issues. And actually it's not, it turns out it's not always so special. And actually, you know, that's why there are, you know, most people in the general public who are also having to eat several times a day and engage with these issues, they're not all kind of getting, you know, fascinated by the political issues around food, and they're not thinking that much whenever they're buying and consuming food. So, but, you know, there's something that is a bit different about it. So how has this affected the people who are working in these issues? Did they come to these issues because they were really interested in this kind of food essence, or did they come to it from a completely different angle? Did they actually come into it because they cared about social justice, and they could have worked on any social justice issue, it just happened to end up being in food or whatever it might be? I see the world through a food lens, and most of the people I interviewed either did or had increasingly started to, but it wasn't necessarily the only lens that they would see the world through. This leads me on to this kind of foodie notion as well. I mean, they're not necessarily the people I interviewed themselves, but I think people often assume that anyone working in food issues is going to be just, you know, innately passionate about food and eating and cooking and artisanal and who knows what else. That's not necessarily the case. There were, you know, the people I interviewed, some of them loved cooking, some of them didn't, some of them hated it, in fact, some of them never cooked, some of them, you know, never even did the shopping, whatever it might be. But there was one thing in common. They did all think about it a lot, and they increasingly thought about it as they were more and more involved in the issues that they were working with. So they all had sort of become conscious consumers. However, there are quite different ways of being conscious consumers. So, you know, some of them, as an example I'll be using later, some of them kind of came into it because they were very passionate, for example, about animal cruelty, and that led them to animal welfare issues. And then they were interested in food issues because the food system is where most animals, the animal population in the world, is treated badly. And so that's kind of the route that they got there through. So this sort of relationship with food is quite complicated. Now, the other thing, the way that kind of leads to more the personal relationship with food, what was interesting, so actually the issue of vegetarianism and diet came up with every single person I spoke to, interviewed, and they all had quite different experiences with it. Nearly all of them, in fact, had tried vegetarianism at some point in their life. Many of them were vegetarians or vegans or variations of that. All of them had considered it, and every single one of them had an incredibly well thought out opinion defending their position, and that informed their decision about the level of meat that they had in their diet and animal products that they had in their diet. But that wasn't the only issue. I mean, there's also, and in fact, Simon Fairley, who wrote this book here, so he had been vegetarian for years and then completely changed his attitude and and decision about it, and actually then was promoting meat eating, but as a part of a very specific agricultural food production system. So it was kind of fine, but only in this sort of a context and so on. Now there's also many other issues as well. So there were, you know, some people were much more interested in the kind of human, the kind of human social welfare issues to do with it. Some people were concerned principally about the environmental issues, as mentioned, the kind of animal welfare issues. Some were kind of prioritising local over organic. Some of them really were kind of seeing all of this, but others were kind of focusing very much on one or the other. So what was consistent is that as they gradually worked through their career and kind of became more immersed in the food issues, they all became much more informed and much more opinionated. They started seeing the links. They started having opinions on all of these different issues that they may not have done before. There were also lots of inconsistencies, though. So even though all these people were from the broader food movement collectively, they were not within consensus. They didn't all share the same food habits. They didn't have the same, none of them had the same individual relationship with food as the next person. So there's a lot of inconsistencies as well, which does sort of beg the question, you know, if the people who are passionate about this, who are working in it, who are highly informed, you know, if there's not kind of consistency within them, and I'm not saying there necessarily should be, but how does that then play into the kind of general public and other members of society who are not engaged with these issues? You know, if there's not consensus and consistency here, then does that beg questions for kind of the way that the food movement is going as well? The question of disconnect. And I think in particular, I mean, as Corinna said, I'm now working on the IFSTAR program as well. And actually this was sort of one of the things that attracted me to this PhD research was the fact that I was going to be looking at lots of different issues. And I like to see the kind of bigger picture. And I'm now working a lot more on that with this kind of food systems approach. And the questions that the food collaboration research asks at the beginning before this talk, we get asked, it's a kind of little talking heads, we get asked what we think are the biggest problems in the food facing the food system, and what can civil society do and what can academics do. Well, you know, I think actually one of the biggest problems is that it's massive and it's very hard to get consensus, and it's very hard to get consistency and to then move forward with actions, and it's very hard to get people to kind of, for people to see where they fit in this bigger picture. Some of them are very aware of it, some of them are not so much, some of them are like, I do this bit and that's fine, but I know how it fits in the rest here. Others are kind of like, you know, they kind of see it only really through their corner. Oh, sorry, and that actually is just to credit correctly, that's actually Tim Lang's and Heisman's food systems diagram from their second edition of the Food Wars book. So now I'm going to give you an example of oral history interview. This is Philip Limbury, who's from Compassion World Farming. And this was one of the quotes actually that comes before the clip that I'm going to play. Now, this was quite an interesting point about the way that activists are kind of presenting themselves and trying to make sure that they're taken seriously. Now, not all of them by any means. This is not saying that all of them had this experience at all. This is very much just Philip. But it's quite interesting, that this was quite a big issue for him. And I'm just going to give the kind of context of the conversation preceding this clip and what happened afterwards, and it kind of, I think it's quite a good example of how oral history can sort of contribute to these sorts of complex issues and these understandings. So Philip was describing how he'd got into animal welfare issues. He was talking about when he was younger in the 1980s participating in anti-fox hunting protests. For Philip, he was very much always interested in the kind of animal cruelty first and foremost. That's how he sort of came to it. He was reflecting on the sort of transformation within one generation to the legal changes that then took place, and from this kind of very, protesters on the street to kind of legislative change. So he was sort of reflecting on the place and the role of all the different types of activism, as well as some of the sort of damage that sometimes militant activism can have, and other times the kind of how wonderful that is and exciting, as well as influential it can be. He was then also talking about the significance of leaving his hometown of Leighton Buzzard, where he grew up, which is close to Luton, when he went to work for Compassion World Farming when he was in his 20s. And he was describing how he semi-consciously deliberately shed his Luton accent in order to be taken a bit more seriously. He said that he would often be laughed at in his office because he'd dress in a suit and tie for a radio interview when no one would, of course, be able to see him. And he was then sort of describing the Compassion World Farming offices in the early days, the feel of it, that it was kind of small and informal and casual, and it was very much a kind of jeans and t-shirt kind of place. And this led on to talking about the sort of role of image and how people are kind of perceived. And then after this clip, he was then talking about the impact on him of working with the founder of Compassion, Peter Roberts, and learning about the importance of positioning. He said that he was quite idealistic, and this kind of this shift in kind of realizing the importance of how you position yourself and how you come across, you know, was really important, and this idea developed, and how this then later impacted the changes that he implemented when he returned to Compassion as a director in 2005. And I had kind of mentioned saying how I noticed it was sort of almost like quite a corporate feel to the office. So we did the interviews in the Compassion offices. And he said it was very much a kind of conscious decision to move there. And the changes that the organisation went through when he started in campaigns in 1990, and as the organisation went through huge growth. And he said, when he decided to move the office, he said it wasn't in keeping with where I felt the organisation needed to be. He wanted to reposition it another notch towards the mainstream and get an office space that he could be proud to take anyone. Not ostentatious, that would be wrong, but good, clean, spacious and professional. And that was where the current Compassion World Farming offices are, and they'd moved there in 2006. So there's kind of a whole range of issues that we talked about, and this was in the space of about 10 minutes, and we're just going to listen to a couple of minutes of it here.
Very much so. Image does matter. Much as we would hope, you know, we'd like to think in an ideal world that it doesn't, it absolutely does. What you do, how you do it, the way that you put yourself forward is all very important. And whilst I grew up, in the musical golden era of punk age, well, I certainly wouldn't advocate people who are serious about driving change dressing like a punk, for example. many have. And I'm sure it made a difference, but going to Westminster, you have to look a certain way. Going on the media, it helps to look a certain way. Talking to a broad church rather than a bar full of punks helps to progress, in the way that other people would expect, to be honest, is about matching their aspirations, their expectations. If you dress like an outlier, they'll look on you as an outlier. If you dress in a way which is much more conformational to societal norms, then you're more likely to get actually quite a radical message, to have a warmer reception. And welcome reception. People in the animal welfare movement probably have to overcompensate, have to oversteer in terms of looking as society might expect. And that's why, for example, you'll find me wearing a suit and tie. And when I've done external meetings, conducted external meetings, for the last 20 years or more, I've worn a suit and tie, almost religiously. because it's not what people would expect from someone in the animal welfare community. It's what someone would expect from someone who was, a mainstream part of the establishment. So if you want to be part of the mainstream establishment, you want your views to be adopted mainstream, well, start taking a mainstream approach to get it there.
So, and I quite like that quote and also the context of the conversation. So it really demonstrates how, okay, we're just looking at one person, one organisation, one issue, and it's not at all representative of other people's. But in that one bit, we were able to see I was able to see from the bits preceding that the kind of link between his hang-ups about where he'd grown up, how he'd gotten into food issues through the animal cruelty, how this had then kind of affected the essence of the organisation today. So he's someone who very much believes, he wants to work on at the kind of very high level. And, he kind of said at one point as well, the more radical you want to be, the more conservative or kind of conformist you need to come across as, and that was kind of almost like his mantra. And you could see then how that had completely affected the organisation, which is one of the leading organisations in that particular movement of the food movement. And he, Compassion World Farming now focuses a lot today on kind of, EU-wide level legislation and the practices of huge corporations like McDonald's. So, there's lots of different levels that they can participate in, and they do, and all the organisations and the people that I interviewed worked at lots of different levels. But it's quite an interesting method for kind of capturing a whole range of issues. We're looking at how this one person has been quite a big influence in one area of the food movement. So, I thought that was quite a nice example to use there. And then this is my last slide. So this is just a few sort of reflections on that method. So there are many pros and cons to the method. There are so many things I love about it and things I find frustrating as well. So, as I mentioned, it's great for getting this sort of in-depth understanding of a person. It's one way of documenting history and a kind of lived experience. It's great for exploring narratives. And really getting into the complexity of the issues. Of course, it's only one person's experience. I didn't interview anyone else from Compassion in World Farming. There were many other people who've been huge contributors. And perhaps you could say that actually some of the people, most of the people even, that I was interviewing are the people who are already kind of the dominant voices there, and maybe not the kind of less heard but equally important voices. Obviously, qualitative research, never great for kind of statistically significant sample sizes. That's not the point of it. It was also quite interesting how the interviewees saw me. So, some of them I knew before, some of them I'd never met before. It depended where we would do the interviews, some of them it would be a kind of an intense 2 days, others it would be a kind of couple of hours every few months. Some of them, it was very much in their offices or in the British Library office. They would never want to kind of spend time outside of the interview. Others, it's much more relaxed. It would be in their houses. We spend lots of time outside of that as well. And that did affect things. People were definitely more relaxed if I knew them more. And I think a lot of them also saw me as a sort of fellow activist or sort of fellow friend and very much on the same level, which I think I am. I don't think I misled them in any way. That also affected it, and quite a few of them commented that, they probably wouldn't have been as open if they felt that I wasn't sort of on their side, as it were. So, these things all affect it, and I think these are always important in qualitative research, and I think, in fact, any social research is just not often is considered as much outside of qualitative social research. So, the other thing as well, of course, is that the people I approached and who agreed to be interviewed for this knew that this was going to be part of a public archive, which is very different. Everything they're saying, they're very much aware of portraying this, who they want to be, whether consciously or subconsciously. It's quite different. It's definitely a kind of a presentation of themselves. I think finally, because of all the complexity, you know, I feel like at times it just sort of muddied the waters more. You know, could I come up, are there kind of any concrete conclusions I can come up with other than it's not that simple and they're not the same and there's not that much, you know, consistency and similarity and so on, or are there some quite clear conclusions? I mean, you know, for instance, the whole sort of the concept of the image, it didn't necessarily come up with all of them, but actually it came up with quite a lot, and it was quite interesting. I hadn't really thought about the fact that that's maybe an issue that would come up and so on. So so I'm leaving it there, not really any conclusions, but if you've got any questions or feedback or reflections, then I'm very keen to hear that now and hope I can answer them.
Thank you very much for that. Look forward to some further discussion. I have a question, if I may, which is about the idea of the method that you use of oral history, that you said that it was a way of giving a voice to the marginalised. But all the NGOs that you listed there, you wouldn't say they're major, huge, wealthy NGOs. I wouldn't claim that. A lot of them are friends of ours at the Centre and at the Food Research Collaboration, great groups. I'm not sure I would describe them as marginalised. And then you mentioned about the ethnic groups being very underrepresented. Now, I'm not saying that interviewing ethnic groups means that you're interviewing the marginalised, but I'm just wondering how... Did you really capture, sorry to ask you such a tough question, but did you really capture the marginalised? Well, perhaps we, you weren't trying to do that. So perhaps some clarification on that.
Yeah, so I think that what I was sort of talking about, the marginalised, and maybe I just didn't make it clear enough, that it was more that the sort of roots of the method were seen more as that. So that's not necessarily how it's used today, but when it kind of emerged, it was very much seen as giving voice to the marginalised. And that is something that I have questioned quite a lot. Doing this now, I'm going, well, is, you know, are these the marginalised people? I mean, you could maybe argue that because these are essentially not the mainstream ideas and political issues that the people are working on, therefore that's maybe more marginalised in a political sense. But yeah, it's something that I have sort of questioned as well, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a criticism. I was just wondering about, I mean, I can see that there's a huge value in filling the gap that you pointed out at the beginning about the fact there isn't all history of this. Yeah. So it's very interesting what you've come up with. I just sort of was thinking about that that aspect of it. Can I ask if anyone, for more questions? Yeah.
I was just following on.
Can you say who you are?
Oh yeah, I'm Katie Hudson. I'm a student on the Master's Food Policy program here part time. I wanted to know how did you choose those? What were your criteria for selecting those people in the first place?
Yes. So no, I didn't go into that at all. So I mean, there was already a sort of a set criteria as part of the project anyway, that, you know, that the British Library wanted quite a broad selection of issues captured. So that was sort of my starting point. You know, I knew that I needed to cover sort of quite a broad range of issues. From then on, it was kind of, you know, then it was sort of identifying, you know, who have been the key organisations who have represented and worked on those issues, and then who have been the kind of the dominant people who've been there the longest. So they weren't necessarily all the sort of directors and so on at all, but, you know, they're people who've been kind of working on these issues a lot. And I mean, there's not a very, you know, there's not sort of one way of doing it that fits it every time. You know, you it's a combination of sort of doing searches about the history of each organisation to turning up at, you know, events where everyone is and kind of talking to people and speaking to other people and then saying, oh, have you heard of that person? They've, you know, they've been working in this forever. And then you sort of go and you look up some information about them and go, oh yeah, actually they have, you know, and so on. So it was, you know, I spent basically the sort of first year identifying a list of people, and I actually had about 50 people that I wanted to interview, but I knew that time-wise I wouldn't be able to do that many, and I had a limit of 20. So there are still, it was quite painful actually getting to the point where I said, okay, I have to stop, I can't do any more, you know, and I kind of, I had to be quite quite careful about, you know, there was sometimes there was someone that I felt was really important, but there was already sort of two people that were representing that movement or issue or organisation or whatever it might be, and therefore I couldn't really justify interviewing them as well. So that was kind of quite painful, and maybe that wasn't very representative, and maybe that actually plays into the whole, you know, marginalised voices and you know, did I really capture everyone? No, I didn't. Limits, and if anyone wants to continue adding to the collection, I'm sure the British Library would be very keen.
There's another question here. Again, if you could give your name.
Leo Peng, PhD candidate in the Department of Anthropology at SOAS. I just got a question that will probably muddy the waters a bit more for you, but I'm in that mode myself because I'm writing up my dissertation as well. In your view, what's the difference between an advocate and an activist?
Ooh. Advocate and an activist. Okay. Well, I hadn't really considered this before. I mean, if I go back to my sort of my working definition of activism, which is this sort of change beyond just oneself, I would then see advocate as more, you know, supporting that person or that issue, and not necessarily kind of taking a more proactive role in creating that change. It's more kind of, yeah, I support that, you know, so I will sort of maybe buy this type of, you know, let's take a very crude example. I'm an advocate of fair trade, therefore I'll buy fair trade products, but I won't necessarily go and, you know, try and convince other people to, or try and get my local shop to supply it or whatever, you know, if it's there, I don't know. So, I mean, that's my very crude distinction of it, but I guess that's, yeah. I guess it's sort of being a friend more than a... I'd be very interested in other people's.
Hi, I'm Bali. I'm following in Lauren's wake, doing a very similar PhD with very similar people. I've got two questions. Is that okay?
Sorry?
Not food activism, but oral history, food, University of Sheffield, British Library connections. Can I have two questions, please?
Yeah.
So the first one is just, I'm just trying to figure out how you're going to frame your PhD. Are you coming at it from the professional, personal thing? Is that what you're trying to examine? And then, or is it these themes? Are you going through sort of what makes an activist as a person or something like that? Or, and then how did you deal with this huge mass of words that you've got? How do you sort of go about analysing that in a way that's qualitative and it's from your perspective and it's got feeling and experience in it, but is also in some way rigorous in a social science way?
Yeah, good good questions. The ones that I've been battling with as well, so right on point. So the first one in terms of framing, at the moment, it's I got to a point where I've actually questioned about the way that I have framed it. So it's a very good question for that reason. So I have been sort of framing it more with the themes, and then looking more at that sort of the more specifically the sort of breakdown of the personal professional more in the sort of the analysis of the methodology, and then kind of dealing with some of the issues. In sort of chapters. So that was sort of the way that I framed it, and now I'm kind of questioning that and have sort of been trying to rewrite bits of it and maybe change the whole thing over. So I'm not sure that has been the best way so far. And in terms of, just the sheer sort of quantity of qualitative data, it's overwhelming. So most people are probably not aware, you will be, but the British Library is a requirement. It stipulates that all the kind of oral histories must have a what they call a kind of summary, which is essentially a sort of shorthand, transcription. It's basically sort of not a word-for-word transcription, it's sort of like a, you know, discussion about this issue, mentions that person, reflects on this, sort of, that's sort of the style of it, with kind of regular marks every sort of 5 minutes or so. So, and this is really important primarily for anyone who wants to reuse this data in future, anyone who wants to go into the British Library and use this information. They can down, you know, they can access the audio, but they can also access these summaries and kind of look through and do search words for particular people, for particular issues that will come up, and they can instantly locate, you know, so if they don't want to listen to the whole thing, they can go, great, I can go straight to track four halfway through at this point, you know, they can identify it. So that's the kind of the primary reason for it existing, but I have to say it was really useful. It was an absolute nightmare to do, headache to do all of them, but actually a really useful process to go through because, you know, I had to re-listen several times to every single one. I had to kind of really think about it, condense it all. It also means that whenever I think, oh, I know that there was some amazing conversational quote about that that I really want to use, but how on earth am I going to find it? Okay, well, I can do a search of my own summaries and locate it quite quickly. It also means that, you know, if you do want to do a sort of search for key words of terms, then you can. You can do that in all of them and you can see how often this particular issue comes up across all of the different interviews or within one interview, how many times, you know, someone uses a particular term. You know, if there are kind of key people who keep getting repeated by all the other people, you know, or a particular reference to something. So that is sort of one method. I mean, I looked into using the NVivo, but I didn't feel it was that kind of, it wasn't that useful because that was sort of, I mean, I think it might have been useful if I had full-on transcriptions and if I was really interested in looking at more kind of linguistic, statistical analysis of the linguistics, but which I wasn't necessarily. So, yeah, there's a lot of wading through. And, I think that's part of the sort of where I've gotten a bit stuck at times is sort of like, okay, it's such a mass. How do I kind of decipher the sort of the stories and how do I present it all and how do I have that kind of human aspect whilst also still being rigorous and so on. So, yeah, it's it's a kind of constant challenge. But that has, yeah, the sort of the summaries and the use of those has been actually really valuable. I would have a series of questions. So another way that I would do it would be, you know, okay, well, I want to look at this theme, and then I'd sort of go through all of kind of the key sections of interviews that referred to that, whether it was kind of because it was omitted maybe, or because it was talked about a lot, or because it came up to different people, and I would sort of compile a lot of the sort of key quotes and the key conversations that came up all in one kind of section, and then I'd start writing it out. So that was sort of another way of, sort of wading through it. Yeah.
Thank you for asking that question. I'm Tony Allen, very fond of this seminar. Did you have a research question? And did you answer the research question?
Yes. So, it slightly changed, but not a huge deal. It was, I've heard it right at the beginning. So, actually, that's not. I haven't got a copy of the research question, but this is sort of. I had sort of three key questions, and they broadly sort of came under these. So one of them was looking at the role of oral history in researching food and researching activism and social movements. One of them was about sort of researching, in particular, food, British food activism, and how can sort of a recent history of British food activism be defined? And then the other one was sort of exploring food and identity in the context of food activism. So these were the sort of the main questions that I was looking at in every interview, both sort of before I started the data collection, as well as kind of the analysis afterwards. So I don't know if that answers it enough.
Did you get the feeling during your research that food activism, as opposed to my interest, which is water than the environment. Food activism has just got there. It is absolutely front line. It is on in many papers, newspapers, every morning newspapers. There are two or three entries on food. At the weekend, there are three. So it's arrived. Was your research, therefore, constrained by looking at the stuff in the library, by just looking at that, or what was the relationship between the stuff in the library and your interviews?
And sort of wide, yeah, and the sort of the daily, the sort of current today issues, you mean, and compared with the...
Well, yeah, I mean, in our life, your lifetime, my much longer lifetime, the difference, this wasn't on the agenda 30 years ago.
Yeah,
it's now, if you were to ask, are we worried about whether there's going to be enough food because there's enough water, I can't get that on the agenda. I'm a failed activist scientist. But food activism has got there. I mean, it's an amazing position.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that was one of the drivers for doing this research in the first place, is saying, well, it has, it's had a huge amount of interest and growth in the last several decades, and this is sort of partly was the justification for wanting to research it and look at it and document it and say how has it come about, how has it changed, and essentially a lot of this actually was in some ways documenting that sort of professionalisation of food activism with people who are kind of currently working on it now day to day, who are the people making those headlines often, but often, 30 years ago when they started in it, that wasn't the case at all. they've lived through that sort of fight and that development and that growth. I mean, the first bit of your question was I kind of restricted by this in some ways? Well, yeah, in some ways, and in some ways, that's just sort of the nature of the method, but also the topic is so big. I mean, whatever method or approach you take, you have to sort of focus on one bit of it. And I mean, I was already focusing on so many issues. I couldn't really have kind of delved much kind of deeper, I don't think, into each individual, food movement issue than I did. I was kind of looking more sort of at a distance at all of them, I would say. I think it's too big to have gone any deeper, to be honest, in one PhD anyway.
Out of your 17, how many were women?
About half.
About half. And did you, because you've got gender up there as an identity issue, has that a theme that's come through for you?
It is. It's actually one of my main chapters, or a big part of one of my main chapters. Yes, it was quite interesting. I was very careful about making sure that I had half women, and that wasn't always easy, actually. But no, it wasn't too difficult to find women. I mean, but I was very conscious of making sure that was kind of evenly represented. What was very interesting, actually, was people's responses when I went to them. So this is sort of the easiest data in itself on that. So before we even interviewed, and most of this would just be either in kind of informal phone conversation or in-person conversations, and a few would be emails. So pretty much every single woman who I approached and said, would you be interested in doing this? You're quite a key figure in this movement and so on. They would all be a bit like surprised and, are you sure? I don't think I'm, I don't know if I'm that, really that important. So, are you sure? I mean, it'd be wonderful, but and they were sort of very modest about it. And I mean, it wasn't that the men were kind of arrogant, but there was just quite simply none of that. Not a single one questioned whether they should be asked, and none of them were kind of surprised that they had been identified and approached. Some of them were kind of going, wow, a wonderful opportunity, great, thank you. But none of them kind of questioned whether I should have approached them, whereas pretty much all of the women did. So that was quite interesting. So that was very much an issue I looked at. And I think in particular as well, because, in the VUV movement generally, a lot of the kind of key figures often are seen as the men, but actually there's a lot of women working, like probably more women working in the food movement than men, but they're not necessarily always seen, they're not the visible ones. That kind of ties in again back to the sort of marginalised question or not. Yeah.
The gender balance in this room.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there was a couple more questions.
Yes.
Raquel Ajate from the Center for Food Policy. Thank you, Lauren. I have two questions, linked questions, about the professionalization of the movements. So the first one is whether any other interviewees mentioned that tension between appearing as radical and appearing as professional. And I'm thinking of organizations like War on Want, that their marketing and their campaigns are quite radical in that sense. Mm-hmm. And whether anybody mentioned whether they think they have more impact, like that clip that you play, being more professional, and linked to that, whether anyone mentioned the rise of evidence-based policy in the 80s and 90s as another push to make them more professional and to make them appear as providers of reliable evidence for policymakers.
Yeah, two good questions. So. The first one in terms of the sort of that sort of professionalisation, that tension of the image. So there were several others who, not necessarily in the same way that Philip did, but there were quite a few others who were very conscious of how they were seen, how they were perceived. And I think a lot of this came out of the fact that, you know, often these movements would start out as, you know, kind of, protests in the street or, you know, ripping up GM trials and so on. And even if they were part of that and did, you know, and liked that as well, then they were very conscious of being kind of separating themselves publicly from that in order to get the kind of cause further. So actually quite a few of them talked about that tension. Although I have to say it was quite interesting. It was more the people who were kind of aiming at that high level. So it also came out in the fair trade one with Harriet Lamb, and she talked a lot about, you know, the importance. And she said at the beginning she would sort of try and sort of downplay the fact that she was like an NGO, and then actually as sort of the movement gained momentum and was kind of seen as actually having a lot of influence, then she was like, actually stuff that, let's be proud about this, you know. And she then said it actually gave her an edge later on. That people would respect her more because she was maybe the only person representing an NGO in the room of kind of heads of corporations or something. And she would also talk a lot about, how she really loved, you know, wearing a kind of a suit and heels, even though she was not that kind of person at all. But she would love it because she would buy all of her clothes in a charity shop, but you wouldn't necessarily be able to tell that. And, you know, and she loved getting her heels on, but then would always make sure that she had some kind of piece of sort of ethnic jewellery or something. So they all kind of had, you know, she had some interesting things to say about it as well. And she was similarly sort of wanting to work on those, on that really high level of kind of let's try and change, you know, Nestle and Cadbury's and, you know, however much I like or dislike these organisations personally, actually if I want more fair trade cocoa to be used, that's where it's going to get the results, sort of thing. So, and you know, that kind of focus on the mainstream. Yes, in the answer to that. And the second part, sorry, what was the second question again about evidence? Yeah, so it was an interesting one, actually. Helen, it was so one of the main the champions of this, of my sort of selection of interviewees, who was working more on the evidence-based side of things, actually generating a lot of the information that people were depending on. So it didn't actually feature as much as I might have expected. And sort of looking back retrospectively now, I'm kind of thinking, oh, it's kind of interesting. It didn't come up as much, or, you know, maybe I should have kind of thought about it and questioned it more and brought it up and so on. What you know, what people did comment on was actually, you know, they would use it, but they gradually realised, kind of the point that most of them have got to now is that they've realised that whether they've got the evidence, it's important for them to have the evidence, but it doesn't always help in terms of getting change, and that a campaign doesn't work just on the evidence alone, and it's all about how you kind of present it and the way that you kind of spin it and so on. So they would talk about the importance of them using the kind of evidence and having that and knowing that they're kind of right with that, but not using that publicly. And you know, the evidence alone isn't going to make the changes. There's evidence for lots of things, and actually kind of you know, societal norms and beliefs and so on actually often trump that and so on. So they would talk about a lot of campaigns methods where they would be able to present the evidence in a way that would make the change rather than just presenting the evidence on its own. So yeah, I don't know if that answers it really. Yeah.
Yep. Question about, just to return to the issue of sort of ethnic diversity, but not directly, but wonder if you could talk about the idea of maybe how these activists felt, or whether they felt they were part of transnational global networks with something like Fair Trade, and whether that made them relate to people of other ethnic backgrounds and nationalities in discourse. Say, for instance, maybe someone doing animal cruelty here might relate to an animal cruelty activist in Hong Kong who's doing something about the consumption of shark's fin, say, for instance.
Yeah, so I think, so one of the ways it often came up was that sort of people working on issues and then talking about, okay, so it's not just the UK, these are kind of big global transnational issues. And they would sort of see, you know, if I ever sort of brought up, like, oh, you know, do you, you know, how do you kind of see that the food movement is sort of framed and who dominates and things in the UK, then they wouldn't necessarily notice that most of them are all white. And then they would sort of go, oh yeah, because we work with these other movements, you know, somewhere else in the world, or we're working on issues that are affecting these other people. And, you know, they're really involved in it there. And so there was this acknowledgement of you know, they would very much relate to those, to kind of people in other countries and these shared sort of issues that they're working on or that they're dealing with and so on. It was just this sort of blindness almost to the fact that, you know, there were non-white people in the UK who also involved and care about these issues, and they're kind of not really very big voices in the kind of UK movement. So, yeah.
Hi, Mary from the Food Research Collaboration. First, thanks very much for your talk. I really enjoyed it. And I think the bit about not talking to a bar full of punks will remain in my mind for a while. Mike, I have a question, and it really is a question and not a statement, because I'm not quite sure about it. But do you think food activists who are promoting sustainable, healthy, more ethical diets, which generally you need a certain level of income to be able to sort of follow that, are contributing to sort of increasing disparities in what people are eating? Because generally it feels to me that there are increasing disparities in food that, you know, reflecting increased economic and social disparities. So, but that's just a perception for me. So I'd be interested to find out what you think about it.
Yeah, and in terms of sort of what they're working in and if they see that, and that
in
they,
terms
how
of
they play
that,
into it.
That promotion, the sort of the increasing interest in that area,
yeah.
And they are sort of part of that movement of people becoming more aware of
yeah.
what they're eating.
Yeah, and I think all, if not nearly all of them, were highly conscious of the fact that a lot of the alternatives were not very accessible to many people, and that there were huge tensions in this, and this was actually one of the biggest challenges that you know, facing the kind of food system challenges at the moment. But also I think quite a lot of them were some of them were really working to address this. So even though it didn't necessarily seem like it openly, then what they were trying to work towards, you know, for example, the growing communities. Julie Brown, who I interviewed there, you know, she was highly aware that, you know, these sort of local food movements, organic farmers markets and so on are seen as kind of more expensive and so on. And she absolutely despised that, and she kind of was wanting to get away from that. And it was all about kind of food justice. And a lot of them had this kind of food justice approach to it. It's just that it's not, I think a lot of them felt that it wasn't necessarily seen in the public eye as that. And I think that was part of, I think that sort of plays a bit into the sort of class, the sort of class identities actually. And, you know, that these, you know, if you buy this type of food, that makes you this type of a person. Well, actually, that's not the case, or, and even if it is, then it shouldn't be the case. And these were a lot of the tensions that they were dealing with themselves. And a lot of them were highly aware of the fact, actually, that it was the fact that, the sort of the political and economic system that they were operating in was making these options more expensive when they shouldn't be, and, you know, was making the bad options, you know, cheaper and easier, and this was part of the problem. And, you know, quite a lot of them were very much trying to get away from, from being seen to kind of be these sort of food snobs and only buying this type of food, whilst at the same time trying to live out their morals and buy, you know, ethical food in the various forms that, you know, and it's, yeah, it's complicated. I mean, I don't have the answer. I mean, personally, and in terms of kind of my experience of speaking with people working in this as well, it is one of the challenges, and I think it's something that they were very aware of. It was an issue that came out. That's not really an answer.
No, it is. It's just, I mean, I live in an area that's being gentrified, and it's just totally reflected in the cafes that spring up alongside the chicken and chips. And, you know, it's a completely different group of people walking to those different outlets, really.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, yeah. And I think actually is a sort of example of that. So I think that was part of the approach of, for example, Compassion World Farming and the Fair Trade Foundation of, you know, so even the people, though the individuals working those movements would not go to McDonald's or even eat meat or buy, you know, Nestle chocolate or something, they wanted the change to be in that place, in that level, because they thought, well, you know, there's actually quite a small sort of minority of the population who are going to go and purposefully buy a chocolate bar that's only, you know, that's main identity is about being fair trade. It's much better to go and make sure that Kit Kat has got fair trade chocolate, because that is the most popular confectionery bar, and therefore if we get, you know, or if we can just convince McDonald's to make all of their eggs, you know, non-caged production, then, you know, even if I don't personally go in there, that gets the masses. That is something that people, you know, the general public are not having to deal with that issue themselves. That's kind of, they can still continue and, you know, and they can keep going to McDonald's, but now their eggs are at least slightly better produced. And that could, you know, of course, there are lots of debates about that, and they get a lot of backlash as well. And other people took a totally different approach, said absolutely no way, that's just the wrong, you know, that's the, how can you even work with these people, and so on. So, yeah, but I think that sort of is quite a good example of that tension of, you know, personally they wouldn't, but they're trying to do that professionally at that level. Yeah.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk, it was really interesting. My name's Trishna, and I work in the local food, the Hackney food movement. I guess my question is more on method. When you were talking to the various food actors within the organisations you listed, how did you tease out the stories? How did you structure your interviews or your discussions with them? Because you said you had lots of conversations with them.
Yeah, so I mean, it's not a kind of formal questionnaire or anything, so it's not like I would sort of go along saying, now question, you know, five, whatever. It's supposed to be a kind of fairly relaxed sort of conversation style that's sort of more sort of directed conversation, but is a very uneven conversation because the person you're interviewing is supposed to be speaking about 90% of the time, and so it's a bit unbalanced. But I would generally start off more or less the same. And I would say, you know, let's start off sort of chronologically, and we can kind of use a chronological sort of format to kind of to base this on, but it absolutely doesn't matter if we kind of jump to and fro, because actually, you know, lots of people don't think or look back on their life in this sort of chronological way. They kind of see these sort of over, you know, these sort of circular kind of, oh, and that fed back to that, and that, you know, came up later on, and so on. So I would sort of use that as a guide, but I wouldn't stick to it. So, you know, you'd kind of start off saying, you know, where do you grow up? Who are your parents? I mean, actually, quite a typical way of starting any oral history is starting with someone's name and say, where does your name come from? You know, what are you called? And that kind of often can start it off instantly. Oh, okay, well, that actually I was called that because, you know, that was a family name, or, you know, or actually that's just my nickname, and that came about, you know, much later on, and so on. So, and then, you know, as the kind of interviews progressed, and especially as some of the sort of topics came up that I wasn't necessarily expecting, and I thought, oh, that's come up a couple of times, that would definitely be good to make sure I include that topic in the future one. So then I was have a little note to myself going, you know, if this doesn't kind of come up somewhere, then ask out directly, you know, oh, have you thought about this? Could you tell me what you think? And so on. So, yeah, that's... semi-structured. Yeah, semi-structured. Yeah, it was very much, I mean, that's another characteristic of the method, in fact, is that it's very much led by the person you're interviewing. It's their story, it's their life story, it's their oral history. They've got to feel like it's going the way that they want it to, it's being told the way they want it to. It's very different to a kind of a short or quite a harsh interview or something. It's like, how would you describe all of this? And we would always have a bit at the end where we would sort of reflect and you know, did you feel like this, you know, is there anything else you want to add? And also, especially if there were breaks between sessions, sometimes there would be breaks of weeks, you know, I would always say, if there's anything you think of between now and then that, you know, you'd like to kind of go back on and clarify, that's absolutely fine. And sometimes say, oh, actually, yeah, I've been thinking since then, you know, something else came up that I'd forgotten, and so on. And then also at the end, making sure they felt that they were happy to close it at that point, and that they kind of felt a lot of ownership over it, and that it was their story. So, yeah.
Sure, yeah. I was kind of interested in the driving ideals behind, you know, when you talk to them, what had driven them to work in this area, and more generally thinking about, you said a lot of them, what I've written down as baby boomers, but that kind of born post-war, that a lot of them were that kind of age, and whether growing up in that kind of more Keynesian economic period with the social contract being more visible and that kind of Labour Party background had any influence on them, and if so, whether you'd interviewed anyone younger that had grown up more in the more neoliberal post-Thatcher era, and whether they had different attitudes and different ideals.
I think the oldest person I interviewed was had been born in the kind of the late 40s, and actually the youngest person I interviewed had been born in the 80s. And so that was definitely the youngest person. I mean, that was sort of, yeah, they were in their sort of early 30s, as opposed to someone who was sort of in their 70s. So there was, you know, there was quite a range. And I didn't have a lot of young people because, you know, by the nature of it sort of being a kind of oral history, you know, generally the people who'd been working on these issues the longest are going to be a bit older. So by default, most of them were not as young. And it was, yeah, I mean, the young person who I interviewed was from Food Cycle, which is also quite a new, relatively new organisation as well, working on food waste, which is also quite a new issue in terms of sort of, I mean, it's always been an issue, but it's kind of risen to a lot of prominence now. And it was quite a different approach because it was much more sort of social entrepreneurship. And he very much identified with being a social entrepreneur, and and the kind of like, oh, you wear kind of the jeans and the kind of t-shirt and a smart jacket, you know, and you're going to get this kind of right mix and things. So, I mean, it's, you know, it's hard to tell because he was the only person I interviewed, but, you know, that probably has like to do with the era that he grew up in compared to others. I sort of touched on it a bit, but, you know, some of them had gotten sort of became very politicised very young, but maybe not about food issues, but, you know, it started in the kind of nuclear disarmament movement. That was kind of what a lot of them actually mentioned, that, you know, the time they were at university was when, you know, the CND movement was kind of really big. So it wasn't really about a food issue, but that was sort of what started sort of politicising them. And others, you know, it was very different. They kind of, you know, they sort of fell into it, you know, and, you know, followed this interest and that interest, or kind of actually followed that because they felt like they, you know, well, their parents told them they should or something, and that then ended up in leading to this job, and that then led to that job. And, you know, so actually they never kind of went into it with a particular food or maybe even political interest, but then through the process of their career that changed quite a lot, and they became increasingly interested in the issues and increasingly interested in sort of politicised, they became increasingly politicised and they became increasingly interested in the food issues that were sort of tied into that. So
another question here.
Yeah, another question, yes, third time lucky maybe. I want to return to the issue of what you were talking about with the idea of what food means to these people, and when you talked about the issue of meaning of food to foodies. And what seems to come out from this to me anyway, this is more a comment, is that food seems to have a lot of different meanings, and it can be a vehicle for a lot of different causes with different things of social class, from food justice to something more exclusive like organic, like was mentioned up front with the question. And maybe perhaps the foodie definition of food is too narrow. It's got this hedonistic edge that sort of constrains it a little bit. So that's sort of just my take on the whole issue of meaning.
I mean, it's either that the definition is too narrow or that the social kind of impression of it is too narrow, perhaps, because maybe it means different things to different people. And I think I think sometimes you kind of say foodie and people assume that you're a certain type of thing, and actually maybe that's not the case. So you're kind of asking about the sort of individual.
It was sort of a comment, sort of just to see what.
It was interesting. There was sort of consistency in the inconsistency, I guess, in the sense that, you know, okay, the one thing that you know was common was that they all thought about it a lot. They all had quite strong opinions. You know, they'd all worked in these issues in these areas long enough that they all felt quite strongly about what was varying degrees of sort of ethical food. How that, you know, the details of that though were quite different sometimes. You know, for some people, absolutely, there's no way that you can be part, you know, that you can kind of argue about these issues and then still eat meat. Or, you know, there's one who's kind of absolutely adamant about, for example, having his own allotment and growing his own food, but completely disagreed with organic. And there was another that was all about animal welfare but disagreed with organic, and others that kind of said you absolutely can't separate them, you know. So this was sort of one of the tensions that I was kind of looking at going, so there's quite a lot of disconnect between them, and there's not, you know, there's not that much unanimous, there's not much consensus sort of between them, which I think is...
It seems to me that food can mean so many different things, and that's how these disconnects come about.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's, you know, it's complicated. I mean, you know, even if you look at the sort of academic side, it's constantly being researched and debated and challenged, and it's very hard to come up with completely finite conclusions. And therefore, you know, I think that's reflected in you know, and the people working on these issues as well. And I mean, some of them were very, yeah, I don't, this is a sort of like general ramblings now about it, but yeah, I mean, some of them were very much kind of aware of the bigger issues and their sort of food practices. You know, it played a different role in their lives. They would the sort of the cooking and the eating and the types of food and they would sort of see how it connects to all the issues. And
to flip it around, would some of them engage in this sort of like hedonistic consumption for pleasure of taste and flavor?
Were many like that, you mean?
Would some of them engage?
Some of them. Hugh Fernie Whittingstall, yeah, absolutely. It's, you know, it's kind of the union of the kind of the passion for the flavour and the kind of the social aspect of food combined with the political. That, you know, that was for him what was really important. And yeah, for some that was a big part, but for others, not so much. Yeah. I think Helen should definitely have the last word.
No, I was just going to say, you said you had got a chapter about gender. I just wondered what the other sort of big things that had come out were that you might have chapters on.
I mean, these were some of... I've just realised now as well, and like you said that I haven't got gender on here, which is a complete mistake because it's a huge... These are some of the main ones that are sort of... that formed the chapters. And then I've got quite a big section on the methodology itself and the sort of the pros and cons of it and the limits and...
What was the experience like? Can you talk about it?
Wasn't at all what you expected it to be, because no one normally is very interested in your whole life. You know, so that's really interesting, starting at the very beginning. And it did bring out some really interesting things you didn't think you were ever going to say, which was quite odd. Well, things about, for example, your relationship with your siblings, or things that you actually realise you've resented your entire life that no one's ever asked you about, that now's a really good chance to tell somebody the why. So that was quite interesting, wasn't it? And sometimes because we did it in stages, it was quite interesting because there was a gap between, and you were very good at bringing it back each time and reminding me where we'd got to, which was really important to where it was going. It really does also influence how you move forward from it. And one of the things I was thinking about when you were talking is how much more political I am now than I was when we did that, and how much in the last 5 years everything has changed in the world we're working in. I think it's been a phenomenal change. And I would say probably quite different things now than I would have said when we did it maybe 3 years ago, was it? So it's also very fast moving. And I think that's also an interesting question, if you can pick that up in the interviews, and that's why age and gender and life circumstance will be so fundamental to it, I think, because everyone's journey is in a slightly different place. And but it was also really, really interesting to reflect. And I suppose if I had to put myself somewhere, I'd say I was very much the accidental activist, in that I'd never planned any of it and just drifted. And I don't know if that's more of a female thing that comes out perhaps in your chapter on gender, that perhaps we're less, not all, but some women may be a bit more moved by the circumstances that they find themselves in and the places that they are and their other commitments and how that deals with their working life. Mm. Really early on you said something about one of the men didn't even do the shopping, and that really struck me, you know, that huge big difference that we still have between people's lives.
And that really and that comes into the sort of identities beyond just sort of the typical kind of gender and class and so on. Actually, your identity as a sibling, as a parent, as a mother, as a colleague, all of the as an environmentalist, whatever it might be, all of these would play into it as well. And I think it was it was interesting what you're saying there as well, because that was, they're also the points very very typical to the method as well. A lot of people find it very therapeutic, and in fact one person I interviewed then approached me a few months later and said, you know, can you give me some advice? One of my friends has been diagnosed with terminal cancer and is dying soon, and I want to do her oral history as a sort of, you know, it was such a nice thing, and I thought it'd be really nice, you know, for her to do that for kind of her children, for herself before she dies and things. You know, so people find it kind of quite a sort of reflective and, quite a cathartic process, I think. And the other point that you were saying about, you know, if you did it now, even a couple of years later, it might be quite different. And I think that goes very much with the point that, you know, history is living. It's constantly changing. If you take it at one point, it's going to maybe be different another point. You know, the perspective from which you're addressing it at the time, the time and place is going to affect what is captured and how it's interpreted. And so I think actually that's a really good point, because that perfectly illustrates, you know, the living nature of it and how there isn't just this sort of single truth, and, you know, at the time that's what the situation is, and a bit later might be rather different. So, yeah.